Hello everyone, Mr. Happy here, and in this video, I want to share with you all my thoughts on E3 Day 1. It's actually Day 3 of E3, but because of the weird way that they do it, because of the public versus private, it's E3 Day 1, that's all you need to know. Now, while a lot of things happened on the off streams, both on YouTube and Twitch, the main things that I want to focus on were Nintendo Direct, the Square Enix press conference, and the PC gaming press conference. So we're going to go through each of those one by one. I'm going to give you my overall thoughts on each of them. So first up was Nintendo Direct. Now, I always have kind of a thing with Nintendo Direct, or I'm not a big fan of this whole pre-recorded presentation. I prefer the live presentation, like the NWCs were. I kind of almost wish that was the Nintendo conference. In my opinion, that was the Nintendo conference, because they actually did things and interacted with people, and I don't know, Nintendo Direct just always rubs me the wrong way. However, they do always have a way of at least making it enjoyable to watch, at least on a humor level, but if only in short spurts. They came onto the stage as Muppets, which was funny to see Miyamoto and Reggie as a Muppet, but it has no relevance other than just distracting me from what games they're actually going to announce. And granted, Nintendo always has a decent lineup of games. The thing is, it's just another Star Fox game, just another Mario game, just another weird game that nobody really asked for, but the creative minds at Nintendo decided to come up with. I'll say that's actually probably a good thing, that they have the creative minds to be able to create these new mechanics after all these years. So they actually led with their Muppets turning into Star Fox characters, which revealed the game Star Fox Zero, which we've known about for some time. Star Fox Zero was looking great, looks like old school Star Fox with a lot of new things, a lot of different vehicles this time around, good old, same four characters that we're used to after the entire series. It looked like a classic Star Fox game in the making. I don't think there'll be anything wrong with that game. It's just a matter of needing to have a Wii U in order to play it. Hyrule Warriors for the 3DS, or Hyrule Warrior Legends for the 3DS, which is kind of like a port of Hyrule Warriors that came out last year, but it's got a couple of new characters and stages. It's not going to release anytime this year, but I used to love the Dynasty Warriors games. I've heard Hyrule Warriors is a lot of fun, so if you have a 3DS, you'll probably want to pick up Hyrule Warrior Legends. New Fire Emblem game, I believe it was called like Fire Emblem IF or LF or something like that in Japan. It's going to be called Fire Emblem Fates here in the US, so if you've been looking forward to that game, be sure to keep your eye out for it. Shin Megami Tensei X Fire Emblem. Now, this game was MIA for several years, and I reported on it on Happy Gaming News, I think about a month to a month and a half ago, saying that we might see it at E3. And we did indeed. It got a new Japanese trailer, but that's about it, so not much to really go off of. Interesting. The trailers make me just think, I don't know. It's so weird to see it taking place the way that it does, just the dress up and everything. But that's because I've never really played too many Shin Megami Tensei games, so I probably don't have much to base it off of. And by none, I mean Persona and that's it, which isn't even really an SMT game. Moving on, Xenoblade Chronicles X got its North American release date December 5th, 2015. So if you're somebody who imported it and you kind of wish you had it in English, you're going to have it in English on December 5th. So yay! New Animal Crossing game, a Happy Home Designer. This was, we've known about this again for some time. And instead of building just your own house and paying off your debt, you're almost like a real estate agent for Animal Crossing Worlds. It's actually a pretty neat take on the whole Animal Crossing thing, but their other take on the whole Animal Crossing thing was kind of strange to me. Now, let me see if I can find the exact name. Amiibo Festival. It was like an Animal Crossing version of Mario Party. That's like one of those games that I don't know ever needed to exist. And you know what? The thing is, Nintendo has this weird way of going, what the hell is this? Why would they make this? I'm going to buy this. Nintendo's got a great way of doing that for its fans. I think the Animal Crossing game is going to be no exception. The Amiibo Festival specifically, I should say. Very Amiibo-driven game, in case you can tell by the title. We had The Legend of Zelda, the Triforce Heroes. I almost said Four Sword Heroes because it's a sequel to Four Swords. It's a successor at the very least. And it's going to be all about teamwork. I don't really know. They like to talk about games like, oh, you can really play with your friends and work together. Every time I hear them, I'm like, what if I have no friends? What if I have no friends? And Triforce Heroes looking like a great cooperative old school Legend of Zelda game, kind of like the Four Swords were. So puzzle solving, dungeon exploring, killing bosses, enemies, all that stuff that you love about Legend of Zelda, you'll get it from Triforce Heroes. Metroid Prime Federation Force announced for the 3DS. Now, I found out that this is actually Blast Ball, which I reported about the other day. Blast Ball is a game mode in Metroid Prime Federation Force. Now, a lot of people suggested that it might not be a standalone title just because it seemed like you couldn't possibly make this into a game itself. In the context of being part of this Metroid Prime Federation Force game for the 3DS, now Blast Ball makes a lot more sense because as a fun little game mode on the side on top of the game itself, that should be a pretty good addition to the 3DS lineup. Yo-Kai Watch got a new English trailer. For those of you who don't know, Yo-Kai Watch is like the newest big hit Pokemon type thing going over in Japan. It's appeared in some Final Fantasy XIV media lately as well because of Level 5 Studios being very close with Square Enix. So I wouldn't be surprised to see anything happen with Square Enix and Yo-Kai Watch in the future. But we'll see about that. A new Mario RPG, not Super Mario RPG, don't get too excited. Closer to a combination of old school, or not kind of like old school, like side-scrolling Super Mario combined with Paper Mario. So basically the words of Paper Mario and regular Mario are colliding, and you'll see them side by side. Almost like Sonic Generations, I guess, but with Mario and Paper Mario. It's going to be called Mario & Luigi Paper Jam. If you love Paper Mario, if you love Super Mario in general, it'll probably be a great new title for you to pick up. Paper Mario, one of the greatest games of all time, in my opinion, and that says a lot. A new Mario Tennis for the Wii U, one of my favorite games on the N64. So I'm definitely okay with this. I used to love playing the Game Boy Advance version, and then you would just make a decked out character, transfer it to the N64 version, and destroy all of your friends with it. That was always the greatest. And let me see if there's anything else that I really missed on my list here. No, not really. Yo-Kai Watch, Skylander Superchargers, I guess, is the last thing. But this is kind of weird. There's two new amiibos that are going to be part of Skylander Superchargers, where you can actually take the amiibo and switch it between Skylander mode and amiibo mode. They showed off a Bowser and a Donkey Kong thing. And they're all going to be able to be part of this game with Skylander. Skylander is a huge thing. Unfortunately, it's where Spyro, my childhood, has gone. So as much as I love Spyro, I guess I would love Skylanders if I gave it a chance. I'm just not willing to do that whole... I'm not big on the whole collecting things in order to play a game kind of deal. It seemed cool when I was a kid, and it's probably a really, really, really cool thing for kids right about now, or even just old school collectors of Nintendo stuff. But in terms of functionality of a game, I never really enjoyed, you know, games where you had to collect parts and go out and buy them separately. But for those of you out there who love amiibo collecting, who love Skylander collecting, you now have something else to add to your repertoire. Now, that was just the Nintendo Direct conference. We do have the Square Enix and the PC Gaming conference. Let's move on to Square Enix next. Now, like I said, Square Enix is up next, and let me just say this ahead of time. Square Enix, you presented a lot of great games. They may not have all been Final Fantasy or Kingdom Hearts games like some of your fans like to, you know, think that's the only thing you make, but you guys had a great lineup of games. But by God, learn how to have a press conference. It was so stiff and uninteresting to watch, no matter how great the games were that they were presenting. Ugh, it was just, it sucks because they really did have a great lineup. I mean, let's just look. Just Cause 3 looked like Michael Bay's dream game. Explosions, crazy things you're able to do, a giant world. It looked like a beautiful game, and it's going to be launching on December 1st for Xbox One, PS4, and PC. They just did a horrible job at presenting it. But Just Cause 3, if you're a fan of Just Cause 2 or Just Cause 1, I hate saying Cause, Just Cause 3, Just Cause. Just because why not? So, yeah, Just Cause 3, be sure to check that out. Let's see, we have, what's it, Rise of the Tomb Raider. We saw this with the Xbox conference. It really wasn't too much new other than a behind-the-scenes detail of how they detailed Lara Croft and whatnot. We also had the Final Fantasy VII Remake trailer play again. They really shouldn't have given that to Sony because that was just... I don't know, that was like a bad move in my opinion. That could have made this conference way more hype if they had saved it for the Square Enix conference. We found out quite a few interesting details about Final Fantasy VII Remake after the conference, though, with Square Enix. We found out that we're going to be learning more this winter, and that HD version of the PlayStation 4 is still coming out, but that they are, in their own ways, going to be two different games. They have the original crew working on the Final Fantasy VII Remake, but they want to make it so that it's literally not just a graphical update. They said they want to enhance it a little bit, make the story a little bit less, I guess a little bit more interesting to watch or to understand. I'm sure this has to do with voice acting and reworking certain scenes from the old game, but It sounds like it's not going to be the exact same game, just with better graphics. There are going to be modifications made to some parts of the story and to potentially some parts of the gameplay. But we're going to learn more about that this winter. They've been working on it, actually, for some time now. I expect Final Fantasy VII to be out for the 20th anniversary of Final Fantasy VII in 2017, but we'll need more official details on that later. World of Final Fantasy, I again spoke about this in my Sony E3 conference overview. Looks like a good game, other than the fact that it's got the cheesy graphics. It seems like a classic turn-based RPG. They mentioned specifically that there's a new battle mechanic where you can stack your characters on top of mounts with other accessories and whatnot, and that helps determine your power in battle. So building these towers of three parts are going to be integral to taking on certain enemies and making sure that you can really customize your character to the maximum. New mechanic, but it is still turn-based RPG. If you're a fan of those, you'll probably be a fan of World of Final Fantasy. Kingdom Hearts 3 got new gameplay footage, and by God, does that game look pretty on Unreal Engine 4. Holy moly, this was the biggest highlight for almost every Final Fantasy fan out there, or I should say Square Enix fan out there. Kingdom Hearts 3 was obviously going to be the highlight here. And they teased us by first talking about Unchained Key, which, like, we didn't need to see another trailer for Unchained Key, but whatever, it was there, another mobile game for the Kingdom Hearts franchise, you know, something a little bit more social at that. On top of that, the Kingdom Hearts 3 was just, it was a beautiful trailer. It was nice to see some working gameplay of it, to see some of the, you know, special attacks, to see some of the story kind of teased at, some old school characters just becoming a little more old school. You'll find out about that when you actually watch the trailer yourself. We had the new Hitman game. We had a new Hitman mobile game for the IO Interactive. IO Interactive revealed a gameplay trailer for the new Hitman. Oh, yeah. So we had the new Hitman. We have Hitman Go. We also had Tomb Raider Go, which is like a mobile game. They both looked really, really weird. You had Deus Ex Mankind Divided. Again, another great game. That's the thing. All of these games were so great. Just Square Enix didn't know how to present them. But these aren't the only things that they spoke about. They didn't just speak about old things. They also decided to throw some new things at us. So, a sequel to Nier was announced. Nier 2. Some of you may remember Nier. It's quite an old game at this point. But somebody came out, one of those creepy skeleton masks. I can't remember what the dudes are called. And yeah, Nier 2. If you've been waiting for that for a long time, guess what? You're finally going to get it. Of course, Tomb Raider Go, Unchained Key, Star Ocean Integrity and Faithlessness, which seems to be, I guess, I don't know if that's Star Ocean 5 or if that's just another Star Ocean game that was over in Japan first or something like that. It's going to be a PS4 exclusive, and they showed some really good gameplay of it, which was nice. They seem to be trying to go back to their roots here. It's got a slightly larger party. I believe it was 5 or 6 members, something like that. But it looked a lot of fun. It looked like a lot of fun. And I'm definitely going to be picking it up in 2016 since it is a PS4 exclusive. The Final Fantasy Portal app is actually going to be coming to America. We heard about this quite some time ago. Those of you who play Final Fantasy 14 may remember this is the Portal app that would allow you to play Triple Triad on the go. I don't know if they ever worked out how they were going to transfer the portable app Triple Triad to the Final Fantasy 14 Triple Triad like they were initially planning, but we didn't really get any other things other than the fact that the Portal app is going to be coming to North America. It's going to be getting a wider release. I don't know if it's just North America, Europe, all that, but it seems like it's going to be more of a worldwide release. And finally, they announced that there would be a new studio opening up called the Tokyo RPG Factory, and their first project, I should say, is Project Setsuna, which is going to be released in 2016. It is a brand new console RPG, so we have no idea other than that name, Project Setsuna. What's it going to be about, who's it going to be about, and how's it going to play? But hopefully they can revive with this Tokyo RPG Factory, revive classic RPG styles while they have these other departments working on all these new titles that Square Enix involves himself in now, like Hitman, like Deus Ex. Great lineup of games. Just please, for the love of God, learn how to present them next time, Square Enix, or hand them all off to Sony and let them do it, because they did a way better job at hyping things than you did with Final Fantasy. They're like, we are making Final Fantasy VII Remake. Please watch. And it wasn't just because they had the English translator speaking over the Japanese so that people could understand it. The people were speaking Japanese, they were just stiffs. It was unfun to watch. It was unfun. It was the negative of fun. So, okay, with those two conferences out of the way, we then have the final conference of the day, the PC Gaming Conference. And this was, I believe, their first conference at E3, if I'm not mistaken. So let's dive into the details for that right now. So I didn't actually get to watch the PC gaming one. I was in the middle of State of the Realm, and then the patch notes for Final Fantasy 14 went live. But I do have a quick roundup of news here, and I've been reading that it actually dragged on pretty long, about 2.5 hours. It's a lot of runtime for the amount of announcements that I'm seeing here. It had some onstage interviews, trailers, live demos, and I don't know. Let's just read some of the things. So Killer Instinct, which was an Xbox One exclusive, is moving to PC. I'm a huge fan of this because I loved Killer Instinct growing up. I can't play the Xbox One version. I'm not great at fighters anyway, but Killer Instinct is just, it's a great fun fighting game. So that's going to be making its way over to PC. And that was along the lines with also Microsoft. They are going to be kind of, with Windows 10, they seem to be wanting to have a renewed commitment to PC gaming because, let's be honest here, Microsoft hasn't really cared. They just left it in the hands of everyone else. And with all these different platforms like Windows 7, Windows XP, no one cares. Windows 8.1, I love XP. Windows 8.1, etc. They just want to get everything on Windows 10 so it's easier for developers to just develop new games for the PC. We also had Gears of War Ultimate Edition coming to PC. That surprises me. That surprises me more than probably anything else here. Gears of War coming to PC. I never thought I'd see the day. I love the original Gears of War, and that's what we're talking about here. Gears of War Ultimate Edition, the remake of the first one, or the HD version of the first one, I should say. Sure, I loved Gears of War 1. It was one of the first games I played on an Xbox, so along with, I don't know, I didn't play too many games on it, so I guess I can't really say that, but I loved Gears of War, regardless. What else do we have here? There's going to be a new project called Project Blue Streak with Nexon. Alright, Nexon, I don't think we need to care about that, but they say they want it to be, as competitive as Counter-Strike. Not as competitive, but if you're really good at the game, you should dominate people as much as you dominate people in Counter-Strike. That's actually not a bad thing. That's a really ambitious thing to be able to do. It's just a matter of, Counter-Strike's kind of been that way for so many years that people kind of are, it's what Counter-Strike is. I don't know how that's going to translate to a new game put out by Nexon of all companies. I don't feel like that's going to attract people who like that type of Counter-Strike playstyle. I think people will just play Counter-Strike instead because it's Counter-Strike. Who the hell knows? Let's see if that Project Blue Streak ends up turning out okay. DayZ developer showed up there as well, talked about a new game called Ion, but most of the time he spoke about DayZ and how pretty much he didn't expect it to be so popular, so they're having a really hard time actually maintaining it and developing for it. It's supposed to be going into a full feature beta in sometime in 2015, I believe, this year. Let's see what we got here. Yeah, and then they still have some development that they need to do. The beta is going to have a single-player mode, Steam Workshop, and allow people to host their own servers from whatever configurations they want. That's good. DayZ is one of those games, I knew it would overhype itself. I'm really concerned for a lot of the games that come out on PC that get super hyped, they get a lot of attention, and then they're in beta, and then it takes them years and years and years and years and years to ever get fully developed, and by then, their own hype train has already died down. Star Citizen is on that list for me as well. It looks like an amazing game, but I'm hoping its hype train didn't come too soon. Because, they did talk about that a little bit. They talked about Arma 3. They showed off a new expansion area for Arma 3 called Tanoa, which is going to be just like the rest of Arma 3, a giant area with underwater explanation and water traversal being a really, really big thing. Let's see. Star Citizen, again, was mentioned. They didn't really mention too much. They just kind of showed off the motion capture that they were doing for it. Good luck. I'm worried about the game getting out before its hype train is dead. We have the Elite games that are going to be coming out. Let's see, we have Planet Coaster, which is, it's roller coasters, concession stands, happy patrons, popped up out of, a T-Rex suit. The long dead genre, so they say that it was a revival of a long dead genre. If they're talking about Roller Coaster Tycoon, I freaking love Roller Coaster Tycoon. So if this is supposed to be a revival of that, the theme park making kind of game, I'm down. I am totally down for that in every way, shape, and form. Then, of course, we had Blizzard and ArenaNet. They decided to come out and talk a little bit. Heart of Thorns is able to be pre-ordered now. And they also showed off the Guild... I almost said Guild Walls. Guild Halls feature for Guild Wars 2 that will be in Heart of Thorns. So, Heart of Thorns is looking like a really top-notch MMO expansion, especially coming from Guild Wars 2, which has been the free-to-play model of buy-to-play and then free-to-play after for quite some time. You're going to be able to build these halls, and then you're going to be able to take on other guilds in order to capture their halls. You can use things like airships and other siege tools in order to get this done, and there will be leaderboards and whatnot in order to track the progress. That's good. That sounds like something that Guild Wars needs wars between guilds. Literally, that's what this feature is, and that's the perfect thing that they could have added into the game. So props to you, ArenaNet. If you're looking to pre-order Heart of Thorns, it is available now, so go check it out. Blizzard also mentioned a three-part prologue to their new expansion for StarCraft II, Legacy of the Void. It's going to be free to play, but it's going to be a three-mission prologue, very specifically, not three parts, I guess you should say, that will bridge Heart of the Swarm and Legacy of the Void together. If you pre-order Legacy of the Void, you'll get early access to these missions. If not, they'll be free to play at some point anyway, so don't worry, it's not going to be a paid three-mission prologue. And also the new DLC for Heroes of the Storm, the Diablo one that I mentioned in Happy Gaming News. It's going to have a new character. It's going to have Leoric. It's going to have the monk character. It's going to have a new map, apparently. It's just a brand new content pack for Heroes of the Storm, which is good considering the game just came out. They're already announcing this stuff. That's one way to really get people interested or keep people interested in your brand new game, something that Blizzard's not done a great job of in the past. So I'm glad to see them doing it with Heroes of the Storm. Good on you, Blizzard. And then finally, we had, there's so many things that were spoken about in this 2.5 hour. Beyond Eyes, we have a new game called Dirty Bomb, which is an action-y shooter type game that's kind of edgy and cool, according to this description of it. We have European Truck Simulator, which is coming across to the United States as American Truck Simulator. But the one thing that's cool about that game is it actually uses Google Maps to make the maps for the game. And that's a really, really cool use of Google Maps, something I'd never expected to see in a game in the first place. We have Rising Storm 2 Vietnam, which is also Rising Storm 1, pretty good game. Deus Ex Mankind Divided had a little bit of a section there as well. We had Tacoma, which was mentioned during, I believe, the Microsoft, pretty sure it was the Microsoft one. It may have been one of the other conferences, but it's something it's like a game that's set in a small space station. I really couldn't judge too much of it. There was a lot of just talking and walking around in the spaceship, and there wasn't really too much. It's something we need more information about, but it's a sequel to Gone Home. I guess not really a sequel, more like a just his next title, the guy who worked on Gone Home. This is his next project. It's called Tacoma. So if you're looking for, if you enjoyed Gone Home, you should enjoy Tacoma. And also, No Man's Sky, we found out, is going to be coming to PC the same day as PlayStation 4. So now I'm pretty much just going to pick up No Man's Sky on PC. Yay! But we don't know when it's going to be coming out. We saw a lot of details about No Man's Sky in like a 3 to 6 minute demo during the Sony conference. It's looking phenomenal, especially if you just want to chill out and explore planets and just fly around an endless world. Like I said, I hope the scope of that game doesn't take away from the gameplay itself for that game. And that is my day one thoughts. Those are my day one thoughts for E3. Day three, day one, who cares? Whatever. PC gaming, Sony, I can't get it right. I've been talking too much. PC gaming, Square Enix, and Nintendo Direct. All great. There were some other things that were shown, but mostly just more information about things that we already knew. So let me know what you thought about E3 day one. Is Sony or Microsoft still your winner from day zero, or did you enjoy Nintendo Direct, the Square Enix conference, or what was the PC gaming one the most? Do you have a new winner? I don't. My winner is still the same. Thank you everyone for watching. I will see you guys in the next video, which will probably be Final Fantasy 14 related, because Heavensward. Anyway, I'll see you guys next time. Until then, take care.